breaking out of its shell, this oil major is shifting course towards cleaner energy. This week on Managing Asia, I talked to Ben van Beurden, CEO of Royal Dutch Shell, in an exclusive interview. On the sidelines of the recent Singapore summit, I met the CEO of Royal Dutch Shell, Europe's biggest oil and gas company. Ben van Beurden comes across as sharp, charismatic, with a sense of mission. A lifer with Shell for over 30 years, he took over the helm in January of 2014. 6 months into the job, he witnessed the great oil crash.
If you are in the commodities business, you have to be prepared for a downturn. And fortunately, we were. I think I inherited a company in a pretty good shape. I think not only were we ready from a position of strength, I think it actually helped us to really accelerate and bring focus to the things that needed to. We needed to significantly reduce the break-even price of some of our upstream operations, and actually having a sense of crisis in the company can actually be a great friend and a great help.
Navigating a company with more than a 100-year history, Van Beurden orchestrated Shell's seismic move from oil to gas, buying BG Group for $55 billion in a mammoth acquisition, the biggest energy deal in a decade, one that said would define Van Beurden's legacy.
We used it as a great opportunity to acquire another respected competitor and really accelerate our strategy with about 10 years. So altogether, when I look back on it, it had its moments, but I think in the main, it has really helped me accelerate the strategy that the company needed to execute.
Oil has really struggled to stay above $50 a barrel. You've changed the company's mindset to adopt a forever lower oil price environment. What's behind this pessimistic outlook?
Well, I don't think I'm necessarily a pessimist when it comes to the oil price outlook. What I do think, it's just so hard to really understand what the oil price is going to do. So if you have a strategy that is predicated on really trying to understand what the future of the oil price is going to be and then betting against it, or betting on it rather, I think you're basically betting the company. So you should never have that as a philosophy.
So you try to assume the worst case scenario?
Well, yes, but then you should be very careful that you don't forgo optionality as well. So you need to make sure that you, first of all, build a lot of resilience in the company. So making sure that the projects that you do have the lowest possible break-even price, so that you can also survive with a portfolio if the oil price comes down further. But at the same time, you can still enjoy the upside because you know that we are going to go through a commodity cycle from time to time. I do believe the fundamentals of the market are such that there will be more upward pressure than downward pressure, but nobody can predict how it's going to play out, neither can I. So therefore, our mindset needs to be building resilience. And you do it with a lower forever mindset.
But I am going to get you to predict, where do you see prices in the near term?
I knew you would try. In the near term, I think it's very difficult. And let me say a few things why it is difficult, and then maybe try to also give a little bit of a hint where I think things might go. You know, demand is still growing. Demand has grown almost since the discovery of oil more than 100 years ago. Maybe there were 1 or 2 years in recent memory where demand slipped a little bit as a result of the crisis in 2008. But demand also grows right now. It actually grows quite resiliently, about 1.6, 1.7 million barrels a day. The supply picture is a whole lot more complicated. First of all, it's a mix of OPEC, it's shales, it's large complex projects, and they each have their own dynamic in terms of, you know, response time to prices, delay effects or not. And on top of it, there's a lot of sentiment that is feeding also how the markets work or don't work. So as a result of all of that, it's very hard to predict what's going to happen in the near term. I do think oil prices are going to go up over time as a result of the tightening of the market.
What price level are you looking at?
Well, you know, again, hard to say, because a lot of it will in the end be driven by sentiment. But we said, you know, it's not unreasonable to expect that if we want to make sort of financial projections going out in the future, we sort of want to make projections around $60 oil by the end of the decade. And we want to show that at $60 oil at the end of the decade, which is not an unreasonable assumption to make, we will be making a very significant higher amount of free cash flow than we used to do when oil was still $90 a barrel. It doesn't mean that I believe that it's going to be exactly 60 at the end of the decade, but it shows that we have transformed the company to be much more resilient in a lower oil price environment.
Well, OPEC thinks it can shore up prices by cutting production, but we had the World Bank coming out to say, you know what, it's going to be the U.S. shale producers who are going to play a bigger role in supporting oil price at that $60 barrel that you're talking about. Do you agree?
Well, I think in the short term, there is a certain degree of range boundness, which is the result of shale. I do think shale has a relatively good capacity to respond to price signals. It goes relatively fast compared to the more conventional, large, complex deep water projects, for instance, that the rest of the industry is involved in. So yes, I do think shale has the capacity to buffer. But I would not say that has made OPEC irrelevant. Far from it. OPEC is still a very, very significant stabilizing force in the market. And it also doesn't mean that the future is just going to be shale. Bear in mind, this is still a very small percentage of the total supply picture. And also bear in mind that small imbalances in the market, 1.5%, can have major effect on pricing, which is the peculiarity of our industry.
A rise in oil prices and strong refining operations more than tripled Shell's profits in the second quarter, with cost reduction efforts further improving cash flow and debt levels. The oil major has also been actively disposing assets. Since the oil price crash, you've sold off about $25 billion worth of assets and taken out costs by about 20%. Where do you see further restructuring?
I think this is a continuous journey. And of course, with the acquisition of BG, we were able to accelerate quite a few things. We saw lots of potential for synergies, which we have now more or less delivered on. And on the back of it, indeed, we have been able to take about $10 billion of cost out of our annual operating budget. So we are now running the company at a lower cost level than we used to be as the Shell standalone case. But also on the back of, you know, a much better project pipeline, much more opportunities, innovation in our projects and technology outfit, we have taken about $20 billion out of our capital spend every year. And on top of it, we have been able to really upgrade the portfolio with much younger, more vital, longer life assets. And that's the $30 billion divestments that we are in the process of doing. And we are indeed, as you say, a very long way towards completing that. But the journey never stops. We will always have to renew our portfolio. We will always have to divest those parts of the portfolio that are running out of steam. We always have to think, can we further reduce the capital intensity of our projects to build that long-term resilience, hence the lower forever mindset. And I think in cost, we're not yet done. I don't want to put a target out there, but I know that we can further improve the efficiency of our operations.
Well, you've used this phrase, getting fit for the 40s.
Yep.
If oil price climbed to, say, 50 and even 60, like you talked about, could it take away some of the pressure to take away some of that costs?
That's the risk that everybody talks about. If if the oil price goes up, will prices go up in general? Will suppliers who have been under pressure today will start to raise their rates and everything else? Well, you know, I'm sure there will be again a little bit of inflation pressure in the supply chain of our industry. But there's also a lot of overcapacity still in the supply chain too. But at the same time, also, I think we have adopted a completely different mindset of devising projects. It is sometimes believed that we were just cutting a little bit of fat away because we had grown lazy and complacent. There's an element of truth in that, of course, always. But it's not everything. It's also not that we have squeezed suppliers harder. I think we have really thought hard, how do we differently conceptualize projects? How do we do things in a fundamentally different way?
You're trying to make things more efficient.
Well, more efficient, more fit for purpose. Maybe actually, going for the higher value parts of the project first. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, I think most of the cost reductions and most of the efficiency reductions have come out of that conceptual change. And that won't go away when the oil price goes up.
Well, as CEO Shell, you've also starting to change the company's business model. You made headlines last year when you acquired BG Group, a big LNG player. What's driving the shift to become more of a natural gas player?
Yes, we had a strategy at the time when I became CEO of growing our integrated gas business, growing our deep water business. We saw these as two very important priorities. And guess what? BG, when it came into range for us to consider as a result of the downturn,
the timing
as
was
well,
right.
The timing was indeed right. These were the core competencies of BG as well. So we acquired a company in a way accelerating our strategy with almost 10 years. And in one fell swoop, we became not just the largest integrated gas player, LNG player, we became the largest by a margin. And deep water, we say, well, you know, there is a lot of running room still. We want to continue to really over-invest or invest more in deep water to make it an even larger part of the portfolio.
So you are looking to acquire more LNG assets?
No, I think it's at the moment we have a pipeline of opportunities to work on the supply side. I think we have plenty of prospects to develop LNG supply projects. I think at the moment, I think our priority has also shifted to much more market development. The LNG market is changing quite dramatically. It is maybe a bit slower than what people are thinking of, and maybe in a slightly different way than maybe the sentiment around this market, but the market is definitely changing. We are the largest player in it. We want to have a strong integrated position, which basically means we have to have more market capability to pull supply into that supply chain.
So as you focus more on LNG, what's going to happen to your oil portfolio? How big a player will you continue to be in the oil space?
Well, in terms of gas and oil, you know, we're about 50-50. Mm-hmm. And I would imagine over
time...
Could
gas overtake oil?
Well, in a way it has, in our portfolio, of course. And I think over time, we will be more clearly a gas company than an oil company. But it doesn't mean that oil will lose its relevance overnight, far from it. But we do think the growth in natural gas, for very good economic but also climate change reasons, will continue to persist. And therefore, we think, you know, betting on gas as the fuel of the future, as a very important part of the energy mix, is important. But it's not just oil and gas. We have to be competent and capable also in electricity, new energies, as we call it, petrochemicals. So these are the things that are almost a third leg on the stool.
Let's
that
talk more about this third leg, because as CEO, you've not shied away from this great glowing global debate on climate change. But as CEO of an energy company, how challenging is it to find viable business models for the new energies business?
It's a bit of a mix, I would say, Christine. Many people think when they, you know, think renewables or other than oil and gas, they think you should go into the manufacture of solar panels and batteries, etc. That's where the charisma really is, and technology innovation and everything else. I don't think that is a good business for us to be in. I think it's not necessarily a good business at this point in time at all.
So what exciting things are you focusing on?
So the exciting things in my mind is, you know, understanding how the whole electricity market and the whole electricity supply chain is evolving. Because it is. I think the whole supply of electricity becomes much more dynamic, partly because of renewables that enter the mix, but partly also because of, you know, other considerations, the interaction between renewables, gas, storage, the difficulties that sometimes governments and markets face in making supply and demand meet. Supply has become much more dynamic. Consumers and customers are much more driving the dynamism in the electricity space. And now, all of a sudden, we have created a business environment which is very compatible with our core skill set, which is playing it close up to the customer, which is trading, which is integrating systems, making arbitrage opportunities, optimizing choices in the supply chain, globalizing all of that.
And making a difference at the same time.
And at the same time making a difference as well. Mm. I think the electricity system is going to grow tremendously. Renewables are going to be a very significant part of the energy mix going forward, and we need to be part of that opportunity set as well.
Well, Shell beat expectations when it reported second quarter earnings. Profits surge as a result of heavy cost cuts and this partial recovery we're seeing in oil price. Where do you see the rest of the year?
Let me shy away from making an earnings forecast, which of course we do not do as a company. Much, of course, will depend on the macro environment that we see, but I do believe that we are on a fundamentally different trend. We have now four quarters of very, very solid earnings on the back of
the deal. And that will continue?
And I think, you know, we of course, much depends on how the margin environment will evolve, but I do think that the company is in a different phase in terms of its capacity to generate cash, with actually more to come. More to come, not only in how we improve efficiency by further cost takeout, how we improve and optimize our investment program, but also how we bring new assets online. We said a few years ago, by 2018, we will have $10 billion per year of new cash flow from new assets. Well, a significant part of that is yet to come. So, you know, think of the new assets that we have under development and under active commissioning and startup. I think, yes, there is more to be expected from Shell. I think we are at a halfway point.
Don't go away, coming up next.
I think peak supply will not come. It will be peak demand. When it will be is very hard to predict. But if everything works really very well, it may be in the early 30s, if not in the late 20s.
Managing Asia, we'll be right back. Hi, I'm Christine Tan, and thanks for watching Managing Asia on CNBC Live. You can check out more of our great content by clicking on the videos on screen. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel for the very best in feature programming. Thanks for watching.